Hello everyone, I'm Dr. Sneha and welcome back to PerioHub. So in the past few videos, we've been speaking about the theoretical aspect of periodontology. So today, let's digress a bit and talk about the practical aspects so that it's helpful during your practical exams. So today, we'll be talking about the clinical aspects of the gingiva. How exactly are we supposed to distinguish the healthy gingiva from gingivitis and periodontitis? So overall, let's make this video helpful for your practical exams and your chairside viva. So let's get started. So broadly, we are going to talk about the difference between the clinical features of a healthy gingiva versus any particular case that you are given. So this is an example of a healthy gingiva. So as you can see, the oral cavity is absolutely plaque-free. There are no deposits which are seen. And the gingiva itself looks so healthy. It is pink, it is present exactly where it has to be present on the tooth surface. Now, in comparison to this, if you are given a case like this, wherein there is a lot of deposits, especially there are more deposits in the anterior region as compared to the premolars and the canines, and with the deposits you can see the gingiva is also swollen. So as you can see over here, there is a slight swelling of the marginal gingiva. The interdental papilla also looks erythematous and swollen. So what are the clinical features that you need to notice, and how exactly are you supposed to tabulate them and put it in a good format? So this is a gingival status chart, which is usually followed, and it basically consists of six parts. So here we have the first sextant, which is of the right upper region, anterior upper region or the maxillary region. This will be our left, and similarly here we have the mandibular region. So left mandibular, anterior, and the right mandibular. So in this particular format, you have to write the clinical features, which further are divided into 8 subcategories. So you have to mention about the color, consistency, the size, the position, the contour, the surface texture, bleeding on probing, and ultimately the exudation or the pus discharge. So let's see each feature in detail. So first, let's talk about the color. Now, if you see the healthy gingiva, what is the color that you notice the gingiva to be? Now, normally we'll say it is pink in color, but if we become more specific, then you might say it is pale pink or coral pink in color. And in most of the situations, especially in our country, you will see certain pigmentation also involved. So a bluish pigmentation, which is the melanotic pigmentation, will also be seen, but this is normal. It is physiological. There is nothing wrong with the gingiva. Now, coming on to the case wherein you see so much of deposits, obviously because of the deposits and the plaque, there is inflammation, and because of the inflammation, the gingiva will turn erythematous or it becomes reddish in color. Again, always mention what part of the gingiva is erythematous. So in the maxillary area, I can say erythematous marginal gingiva and interdental papilla. In the mandibular region, I can say diffused erythema in the mandibular anterior region. So always mention the area. Be specific. Now, why exactly there is color change in the gingiva? This can occur because of two major tissues. One would be our epithelium and the other will be our connective tissue. So during the process of inflammation, there is increased in blood flow, there is increased vasodilatation, increased new capillary formation. So this basically imparts a reddish hue to the gingiva. Now, in another case, such as case of hyperkeratosis, you can see areas of whitish discoloration. This occurs because there is increased in the epithelial cell layers, and this obstructs the visibility of the reddish blood flow which is occurring in the connective tissue. So in case of healthy, what will you write the color to be? It will be either pale pink, and in case of the particular clinical picture that we saw, we can write it as erythematous marginal gingiva and interdental papilla. Coming on to the next category of consistency. So in the healthy situation, the consistency of the gingiva, as you can see, it's very firm and it is resilient. That means if we apply force, it will not get deformed easily. So it is firm and resilient in case of health. Whereas if you talk about the classical case of gingivitis, so it can become soft, it can become spongy, it can become edematous. So these are the terms that can be used. But again, always try and be specific. Talk about what part of the gingiva are you referring to. So is it the marginal gingiva, is it the entrodental papilla, or is it diffused edema involving the marginal, attached, as well as the interdental papilla. Now again, why does the gingiva become edematous in case of gingivitis? It is again because of the underlying inflammation. So the connective tissue becomes highly vascular. There is increased infiltration of fluids and cells. So going back to the chart, in case of healthy gingiva, you can write the consistency to be firm and resilient. And in case of gingivitis, again, be specific. So you can always write soft and edematous interdental papilla in relation to so-and-so teeth. Now coming on to the third, which is the size. So if we see the healthy gingiva, and if you are asked what is the size of the gingiva, you will say that it looks normal. So the size in healthy gingiva is normal. And whereas if we talk about the case, definitely over here you can see there is swelling of the marginal gingiva, and the interdental papilla also looks a bit more increased in size. Now size of the gingiva can be increased in particular area. So as you can see over here, there is increase in size in relation to the canine, the lateral, as well as the central. So make sure you specify which areas are you talking about. So coming back to our chart, the size is normal in case of healthy gingiva, whereas it is increased in case of gingivitis. Next, coming on to position. So again, in case of healthy gingiva, the marginal gingiva is always present 1 to 2 mm coronal to the CEJ. So normally through naked eyes, you can never see the CEJ. But what happens in our case? Now in this particular picture, there is a lot of deposits and calculus, so you cannot really appreciate the position. So let's see another clinical picture wherein we have removed the plaque and calculus. So here, as you can see, in the maxillary anterior region, the position is coronal to the CEJ. But in case of mandibular region, if this is the CEJ of the tooth, the gingiva is present apical to the CEJ, almost like 5 mm apical to the CEJ. In case of normal gingiva, it is present coronal to the CEJ. So remember, CEJ is taken as a standard reference, or in our case, it was apical to CEJ in case of 4-1. Next, coming on to the contour. Now the contour of the gingiva is always scalloped. Now what is scalloped? So this is the shape of a shell which is scalloped. So as you can see, the gingiva here is also mimicking the shape of the shell which is scalloped in nature. And if we talk about the margin, that is the intersection between the gums and the tooth, in case of healthy, it is knife-edged margins. Now what happens in case of disease or in case of gingivitis? The borders are rolled out or rounded in nature. Now let's see one more quick example. So here the tooth is highly scalloped. So if you see, it's highly scalloped in nature. Now one more important point that we need to take into consideration when talking about the contour is the interdental papilla as well. So what is the contour of the interdental papilla? Now in anterior region, it is pyramidal in shape. So it has a sharp point, whereas in case of posterior region, it is call shaped or tent shape, and between the lingual and the buccal peak, we have a depression. So this gives rise to a tent shaped area in case of posterior teeth. Now what happens in case of disease? Now there can be different types of configurations of the interdental papilla that can be seen. For example, the papilla can be blunted, or it can become bulbous, or it can become cratered. So here there is complete loss of interdental papilla. It does not fill this particular space. So if we go back to the chart and we have to write about the contour, in case of healthy, we can write scalloped with pyramidal interdental papilla. Whereas in the particular case that we saw, we can go ahead and write highly scalloped in relation to 4-1. Coming on to the surface texture. So if we see the healthy gingiva and we zoom in a bit, observe that the attached gingiva in case of health is stippled in nature. Stippled means that there are small pits that you can clearly see, or these are engravements which are seen. So it gives you an orange peel like appearance. So have you seen an orange peel? It has small engravements on it. So similarly, the gingiva appears stippled in nature. Now it happens because of the reti ridges which are present between the epithelium and the connective tissue. So are you seeing these projections? So the connective tissue is projecting inside the epithelium. So because of these projections and the depressions, these stipplings are seen. In case of inflammation as such, the stippling is lost. So if you can see the lower anterior region, and if you see the attached gingiva, there is no stippling that you can see. So this is basically again caused because of the increased inflammatory infiltrates within the connective tissue, and this basically causes the loss of stippling, and the demarcation between the epithelium and connective tissue more or less becomes very smooth. So stippling is present in case of healthy gingiva, and then you can always write loss of stipplings in relation to 4-1, 4-2 and 4-3 and 3-1 and 3-2. You can always mention, it is always good to be specific. Then coming on to the last two criterias, which is bleeding on probing and exudation. So in case of health, if we insert a periodontal probe into the gingival sulcus and walk the probe without applying much pressure, then normally we do not see any bleeding on probing. Now this mainly occurs because the epithelium here is intact, there are no ulcerations, whereas the connective tissue here is not inflamed. Now when we go into the case of disease with gingivitis or periodontitis, then subsequently there is plaque accumulation, there is deepening of the gingival sulcus, there is ulcerations of the epithelium which is seen, the connective tissue is also inflamed. So these are the basic reasons why the gingiva starts bleeding when the probe is walked through the gingival sulcus in case of the disease. Now one more condition that can occur in case of disease is the presence of pus. Now because of increased connective tissue infiltrates, it will ooze out of the gingival sulcus or the periodontal pocket as a exudate, and this in normal language is termed as the pus. So if we apply certain pressure with the help of a thumb, then the gingival sulcus will ooze out pus in certain cases. So this specifically shows us increased disease activity or active disease process in that particular area. So in case of healthy gingiva, there is no bleeding on probing and there is no exudation. Whereas in case of the disease, bleeding on probing is present, and exudation, again, it can or cannot be present. If it is present, again, always be specific and mention the tooth wherein you see exudation. So with that, we finish our 8 criteria: color, consistency, size, position, contour, surface texture, bleeding and exudation. So this finishes the gingival status recording for our particular case, and you can interpret so much out of this information that you get. So apart from these broad categories, there are other small things that can be seen in gingival status, like presence of Stillman clefts, McCall fistules, and we'll be talking about them in the later videos. So I hope this video was helpful and it gave you a broad idea how to examine the gingiva and how to write down the correct terms and how to defend it. And we'll be back very soon with the next video, and please leave your suggestions in the comment section below. If you like this video, please do like, share and subscribe. And until we meet next, take care of yourself. This is Perio Hub signing off.